my YouTube channel. My name is Luba the Tabaki, and right now we are about to check Money Heist Season 5, Part 1. And for those who are close to me, know that the original edit got deleted from my phone. But you know the boy never fails. I had to come back harder than ever to deliver for you guys. So with that being said, let's just hop on to the review and let's get into it. For those who want to skip the season recap, you can click on this timestamp to just jump straight to the season 5 review. But for those who don't know, let's check out the season recap.
So we kick things off with the lady that's on the run for a robbery gone wrong. She just so happens to be our main character, the most wanted person in all of Spain for the heist she's been pulling with her now dead boyfriend. Keep that detail in mind because it will come in handy in season 5. She gets approached by a mysterious man who goes by the name Professor, who recruits her for a heist he set out to plan. She has no way to run, so she has no choice but to accept the professor's offer. The professor now lays down the rules for their gathering. No sharing of background stories with one another, no intimate relationships between teammates, no use of real names. The way the rules are set up, it's almost as if we're watching Reservoir Dogs by Quentin Tarantino. If you know, you know. By doing so, we're introduced to the rest of the crew. The main character now goes by the name Tokyo. We meet Berlin, who's in charge of the heist, charismatic and charming, though ruthless when the job needs to be done. Then we meet Moscow, who's an extraordinary miner, a caring father, and a criminal, just to say the least. Then there's Denver, his hot-headed son, known for bar fights and straight-up brawls. He's a real-life ticking bomb. Then we meet Tokyo's crush, Rio, who's basically a top-level hacker. He's like the certified level boy of the group. Then we meet the twins, Oslo and Helsinki, mostly known for weaponry. They're the muscle of the group. We meet Narobi, world-renowned for the next-level forgery she can pull off. She's attractive, but nothing to mess with. She's a complete badass. Then you close it off with the professor himself, the mastermind of the group. He has no criminal record, hasn't renewed his ID since he was 19. He's basically a ghost in the modern-day world. He's like the Batman of the group, and he's low-key my favorite character in the entire show. And what is this heist, you may ask? Well, he's planning on robbing the Royal Mint of Spain. To put that in South African context, that's like they're planning to rob the JSE. The professor teaches them for 5 months. The perfect heist, in fact. His plan is to print out 2.7 billion euros without killing no one. During those 5 months, Tokyo breaks two of the rules and ends up dating Rio. Nairobi also breaks the rules and tells Tokyo that she's doing the heist to see her son again because she's apparently been an intoxicated mother towards her child. Long story short, they take a hold of the hostages and they start printing the money while Masko digs the tunnel from the mint to the professor's bad cave, in quotations. We meet Monica, who's pregnant, but through the troubles she has with her man, Arturo, asks to abort it. Denver tells her not to abort since his mother tried to abort him while she was pregnant. Speaking of Arturo, this has to be the most annoying person in the entire series. I remember I was studying for my trial exams when I caught into Money Heist and they memed the living hell out of this man. More of him in a minute. The professor is in negotiation with the lead investigator, Raquel, and the professor slowly falls in love with her while trying to suck information out of her, and he goes by the name Salva now. No, hashtag confuse the enemy. Back in the Royal Mint, Arturo's plan of trying to contact the outside leads to Monica being caught, in which Berlin orders Denver to kill Monica, in which he doesn't and ends up falling in love with her sometime later. Meanwhile, Moscow finds Sowell, and it's really groundbreaking, pun intended. The group sings their lungs out, and it's truly a happy moment. An uplifting moment, but in their happiness, they relaxed, and the enemy decided to strike.
Helen later finds out that Monica is still alive. You know, she's angry, but yet happy that they actually followed the professor's rules of not killing any hostages.
The professor isn't aware of all of this as he's trying to clean up for the group outside the mint, as Raquel is also suspicious of the professor. The clashing of egos amongst group members results in hostages taking over, being led by El Toro, resulting in Oslo suffering major casualties. It is later revealed that Berlin also has a terminal illness and he can die anytime soon. Just a few months. Season 2 begins with Berlin seeing that Oslo is more or less a dead dog at this point, requests Helsinki to put him out of his misery, in which Helsinki respectfully accepts and kills Oslo out of compassion. Meanwhile, Tokyo tries to take over Berlin's position as leader, since she views him as more of a dictator than an actual person. See, this is why you shouldn't mix emotions with business, as you end up thinking with your heart and not your brain. But Berlin is a minister of society and does easy work of Tokyo and offers her to the police, which infuriates Rio. When the professor finds out what happened, he quickly orders a hijacking to bust Tokyo out of jail, which results in her driving back to the mint to join the crew, but since it's heavily guarded, there's bullets everywhere. Luckily, she survives, but Moscow eventually dies due to the bullets he took while covering Tokyo as she was heading into the mint. The gang manages to squeeze out 9 million euros, which is just below their goal, but they make it in time as Berlin decides to hold back the police off while the entire group crawls out of the tunnel. Professor pleads with Berlin to come out to the tunnel, and it's later revealed in that moment in time that they're actually brothers. Berlin stays behind and gets killed by the police, allowing the gang to move out of the Batcave. Season 3, we kick things off about a year after the heist, with Arturo, who's now a successful TV host and motivational speaker, boasting about how he stood up to the gang and is the actual hero when it came to saving the hostages, even though the gang pretty much bullied him for like the first two seasons, because he kept making a fool out of himself. We meet a gang, same timeline, after the heist, and they're living their best lives across the world. The professor gave them strict instructions of not using cell phones, as it would be easier for them to get tracked. But our notorious couple, Rio and Tokyo, decide to buy them off the black market to keep in touch, resulting in Rio getting kidnapped by the police. Tokyo manages to get a hold of the professor and tells her what happened. In an act of desperation, the professor decides to get the band back together for another heist in tribute to Berlin. Meanwhile, for 2 months, Rio is getting tortured by a pregnant officer called Alicia. The professor recruits some new faces, Bogota, Melania, Mercedes, and Palermo, who has now become the leader of the group since Berlin is dead. Monica, who's now Denver's wife, now goes by the name Stockholm, and they have a son. Raquel also gets a city name and goes by the name Lisbon. The professor plans on melting the goats inside the Bank of Spain, for it's easier to transport that way. And the rules that he set in season 1, no victim, just a clean operation, still stands. They succeed by literally making it rain across the streets of Spain, distracting the pedestrians from the true heist at hand. The gang penetrate the bank and it's back to square one. Professor and Lisbon are negotiating with Alicia while the gang are getting back to work. Then there's Gandia, the government security guard, who's really giving the gang a hard time as he's not buying the act they're pulling on them. While this is happening, Arturo tries to recapture that one high that he once had in his life, because his life is pretty much shit at this point. So he decides to jump back to the bank and join in on the action. Alicia does three crucial things in this part of the show. One, she releases Rio even though they planted a tracking device inside him. Two, capturing Lisbon, making the professor think that she assassinated her, which crushes the professor internally. 3. She later brings out Nairobi's son, which is taken away from him. Remember that Nairobi told Tokyo that she's doing all of this just to see her son again. Being overwhelmed by seeing her son through the window, the order is out and she gets shot in the chest by a sniper. Season 4 opens up with the gang trying to heal Nairobi. Palermo, infuriated by this, shows Gandia how to escape, in which he does. Rio, seeing Palermo escape, but can't do anything about it as he's still traumatized by the torment Alicia put him through. Gandia makes it into the panic room and contacts the police. Gandia makes it into the panic room and contacts the police, who then tell him that he can kill any one of them except the hostages. He's free to do so in the name of self-defense. He then captures Tokyo and holds Nairobi hostage as she still tries to recover from the gun wound in her chest. He promises them that he'll let Nairobi go if they don't fight back, and they respectfully agree, and Gandia lets Nairobi go. He walks back to the crew and there's a moment of peace between the two. Just for him to be like, psych! Jeez, the scene was so gut-wrenching as Nairobi, though she was flawed, but she was on her way into redeeming herself. The professor had even agreed to be her sperm donor just so that she can be a mother again. There's a lot more I can say about her. Rest in peace, Nairobi, and all her fans. Tokyo manages to escape and knocks out Gandia. When the professor finds out what happened to Nairobi, he loses it and blackmails the police by telling the public that what they did to Rio was legal. The police, afraid of receiving bad press, throw Alicia under the bus. But she's like, oh hell no, and reveals that the police were behind the whole thing and that she's now the scapegoat of it all. She then gets fired from her job. The police hunt her down, but she manages to get a hold of the professor's new bat cave, like how Raquel did in season 2. Speaking of Lisbon, the professor manages to kidnap out of custody, like how he did Tokyo, and fools the police to thinking that it's a rescue mission to save Gandia, when in fact it's a mission to put Lisbon back into the Bank of Spain to reunite with the gang.
And there you have it, the season recap. Now for those who want to watch season 5 by themselves, it's okay, it's only just 5 episodes. you'll find me here, I'm not going anywhere. Just watch the season and come back for the review. But for those who are dying to see my reaction in the review, let's just hop into it.
Season 5 kicks off as the professor tries to escape, but nope, he gets apprehended by Alicia and tied to a chair. Bearing in mind that the professor knows martial arts, but gets tied to a chair by a pregnant woman. The professor can be useless sometimes. While the gang tries to decide what to do with Gandia, others say that he must be killed. Lisbon is like, he must live, because that's not what the professor would have told him to do. I honestly feel like they should have killed him there and there. I mean, the guy did kill Nairobi off the roll. Raquel tries to get a hold of the professor, but Lisbon responds on his behalf, and the gang is shocked that they don't know how she managed to get a hold of his bat cave. She then tells the gang that the professor is in custody as a form of messing with their minds. As a form of truce, the gang decides to release Gandia to put everything to rest. But while in negotiation with the colonel, Raquel picks up that they don't actually have the professor in custody and choose to withdraw, so they still hope in their eyes. Arturo, trying to be the main character once again, fires back at the team with machine guns and grenades, and for a moment he's really succeeding as the gang is running out of ammo. He basically mocks Denver for raising a child that isn't his, telling him that Monica was happier with him as just his side piece. Denver, being hard-headed, loses his temper, but the gang manages to cool him down as he's about to get burned by the flamethrower that's in Otoro's hands. Stockholm manages to get a hold of Otoro, putting him in his senses, and there's a moment of reconciliation between the two, but Otoro plans on shooting her, but she shoots first, killing him in that instant. Finally, the moment that I have been waiting for, in fact, that all of us have been waiting for in season 1 has just arrived. Thank goodness Arturo is dead. But out of guilt, she chooses to make the gang resuscitate him. Why, Monica? Why? It's as if the writers knew that we wanted him dead just for them to be like,
Gotti! Gotti!
The colonel brings in the big guns, who come in guns blazing. Hostage or not, they're killing everything in sight. Marcellus is coming back to check on the professor, but finds him asleep, not knowing that he's being dragged to sleep. Then and there, Alicia drags him to her and manages to apprehend all of them while being pregnant. Back at the bank, colonel's squad crashes in through the ceiling, in which the walls close in on Helsinki, crushing his foot. In that instant, he's basically a liability at this point. Meanwhile, Melania is trying to vent Denver about the feelings that she has for him, and I'm like, this chick is tripping for real. Like, y'all are about to get popped, and the only thing you care about is your feelings for Denver. I mean, you gotta be kidding me. In the meantime, Alicia's water breaks and she can make it to the hospital in time. The professor wakes up and tells her that she's got to free him so then he can help her deliver the baby successfully. She's hesitant and tries to do it herself, but nope, she isn't making any progress, so she frees them and they help her deliver the baby. Tokyo catches a grenade mid-air thrown by Gandia and throws it back at him while still in the air. She was on some like Odell Beckham Jr. type shit with that one-handed mid-air catch. Oh man, Stockholm is going through some PTSD over the fact that it was the first time she shot someone. So, she sees Arturo in forms of hallucinations whenever she sees anyone. But she's given an order to go heal Helsinki as they manage to free him under the boulder. Tokyo, Melania and Denver are pretty much trapped. Rio desperately tries to drill a hole underneath them. The rest of the gang are drilling a hole through the wall as the rumble pretty much blocked off the exits. Tokyo is really the MVP of the season. She manages to take down two of Colonel's squad via bullet holes through the wall, but she manages to get some serious wounds and sniper bullets come flying through the wall, taking her down. She's basically a liability at this point. It's literally Denver and Melania left to fend off the infiltrating squad. Stockholm remembers that there's a way out of the kitchen that they have to climb down by. She tells Denver and is willing to rescue everyone, but Tokyo is seriously wounded. Meanwhile, the professor is watching in shock as his team is in the brink of dying. Problema and the others are having difficulty passing through the wall to act as backup for the squad. Denver and Melania make it out of the kitchen and Tokyo is left behind to fend off the squad alone.
Tienes que salvar la vida.
beating like a drum at this moment because I've grown to love Tokyo throughout the show. Rio is also making progress by drilling the floor, but it's not enough. The squad is closing in on Tokyo and the professor is telling her to make a run for it through the passage down the kitchen, but the opposition isn't letting her catch a break. Rio sees her through the hole he's made, fighting them off, but her efforts are in vain. At the back of my mind, I'm like, the writers are not about to do what they think they're going to do. I mean, she's the main character. I mean, she can't die, right? And in that moment, we get flashbacks of Tokyo and her boyfriend before the show even began. Remember, I told you all that Tokyo's boyfriend died from the heist that they pulled off as the show began. So as all of this is happening, we see flashbacks of Tokyo with his previous boyfriend and his current boyfriend. So in my mind, I'm like, it's sort of like a reincarnation, but I'm like, the writers are not stupid enough to kill her. I mean, why? I mean, they can't do that. But nonetheless, the squad closes in and Jules holds through her and everybody's devastated, myself included. Like, there's legit no plot armor in the story. Narumi's death was devastating, but Tokyo's death was indeed gut-wrenching. But in her dying minutes, she manages to take out Gandia and some of his members, as she had pulled off some pins of the grenades jabbed to her body. And that's basically the end of part 1. Gut-wrenching, honestly. Now what I love about season 5 was the removal of the professor out of the equation, because with him, he's pretty much plot armor personified. With him in his bad cave, the stakes weren't really that high. So having him on timeout really made the season intense, because the gang had to figure out what to do by themselves. What I didn't love is the involvement of dead characters. Honestly speaking, the involvement of Berlin in this season took away the momentum that the show was building. I get that he's a fan favorite, but they're really milking the shit out of this man's life. They also try to incorporate Nairobi, but these scenes don't hold that much of weight as these characters are dead, yet they keep making cameos there and there. It's like they're trying to make up for the runtime or something. It's like the Black Widow movie. It's honestly whack. I mean, that movie is a disaster. I mean, she died in Avengers Endgame, and now they decide to make a movie about her, which was pushed back by the pandemic. Black Widow was just a copy and paste of The Winter Soldier, but just a bad version of it. I mean, we got Captain Marvel before Black Widow, and Captain Marvel is just so bland. I mean, I legit slapped at the cinema when I went to watch Captain Marvel. She's literally like Superman with no kryptonite. She's honestly like the most overpowered, yet the worst Avenger. But back to the subject at hand, I'd like to say that RIP Tokyo, your death got me emotional. I mean, I damn near cried.
Thanks for tuning in into the review. I just have one question. Who do you all think is going to die in part 2? My guess would have to be Denver, because the professor, I don't think he's going to die, but I feel like Denver is the one who's going to die. That's my mind. I bet my money on Denver, but then I could be wrong. So put whoever you think is going to die in the comment section below. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share. If you have any movie, series, or even music recommendations that you want me to check out, I'm down for it, guys. But once again, it's your boy Lubanz, and thank you for joining me. I appreciate it.